Hello dear friends, peace be with you. It is said, to be fully aware of what you are choosing, you need to be fully aware of what you are renouncing. Today, I would like to introduce to you a person who embodied this at her best. During one of my summer vacations, I happened to go to this very famous retreat center called the Divineretreatcenter, run by the Vincentian Fathers in the state of Kerala. Catholics from all over India came to this place for spiritual solace. Many do so even today. But it was in college that I had my personal encounter with God and eventually went on to become very active with the Catholic Charismatic Renewal. As I acquainted myself with friends in the Renewal, they all spoke about the Divine Retreat Center and told me how influential it was in their spiritual journey. And there was this one name that I kept hearing among the youth, and it was Maria Sangeetha. I did not know much about her, but I've heard people say that she has been a youth icon and a role model for many in the Renewal. Hearing stories about her life here and there tickled my curiosity to know more about Maria. But all I could find was that she was from Chennai, my hometown, and that she has chosen the vocation of singlehood. Other than that, I could not gather anything about her spiritual journey. I tried my best to get an opportunity to speak with her face to face, but it was in vain. So I gave up on my quest. After several years, as I embarked on my mission with Song on Fire, I started receiving quite a few requests asking me to interview Indian Catholic personalities for the Song on Fire channel. I thought it made sense to showcase the life of Indian Catholics to inspire the Indian faithful. So I prayerfully discerned the people I wanted to interview, and the first name that popped into my mind was Maria Sangeetha. One morning, I messaged Maria to check her willingness for the interview. Given her busy schedule in Divine, I thought it would be impossible for her to find time. But to my utter surprise, she immediately gave me a positive response and we made the interview happen. I was so thrilled to talk to her and ask all the questions that I had been waiting to ask for so many years. It was indeed a dream come true experience for me. But I'm still waiting for the day when I will get to meet her face to face and share my appreciation for the wonderful work that she's doing for the Kingdom of God. Okay, Maria, so we'll start by you giving a brief introduction about yourself and your family.
So my name is Maria Sangeetha, and I'm serving here at the Divine Retreat Center for almost 16 years. I was born and brought up in Chennai in a really nice traditional Catholic family. And I believe I'm so blessed for that. Perhaps at that time I didn't realize the value of my faith, of being born in a family with faith. And but I still remember that as a child, my dad was very close to the church. My parents were very devoted to the church, and every week they would bring home priests. And most often they were missionaries, you know, people who had left their country, left everything to come and work among the poorest, for Jesuit missionaries, Jesuit priests. And I've seen the finest of God's people right at that age. And I believe that must have been the first signals of God working in me to want to give my life to Him. But of course, my love for God and my love for the church hadn't really blossomed, especially towards my teen years, my later teen. By the time I was 17 and 18, I had a lot of questions about God. Like, I'm a person who's always very sensitive to suffering. So I, right from childhood, I've asked, why did God create suffering? Why did He create this? Why did He do this? And so by the time I was 17 and 18, I was still in certain ways a fanatic Catholic, in the sense that if anyone says anything against the Pope or Mother Mary, the church, I would see red. But I personally had no devotion to Mother Mary. For me, Mass was like a burden, an obligation. I would ensure I go after the homily. Certain Sundays I don't go, and I'd say God understands. So that was how cold I had become to God. And especially by the age 20, there's very little connection between me and God. I at one point I realized I could not even pray, you know, I could not even connect. If someone tells me to pray, I'll say an Our Father, Hail Mary. But there was, I think my heart was dead.
Mm. So even though you were brought up in a very strong Catholic environment, as soon as you crossed your teens, you studied in Stella Maris, right? So that time...
I did my schooling in Good Shepherd and my graduation in Stella Maris.
So how was your time during in Stella Maris? Because it was one of the most active time in the charismatic renewal, right? When you studied...
Yeah, but I was totally cut off. We had these annual retreats and especially twice we had a charismatic retreat. I hated it. I remember one of the two people in my third year during the retreat, two very good preachers were giving a charismatic retreat, but we both had completely shut ourselves off to the extent when others were praying for the Holy Spirit, I was actually telling Lord, don't come. I knew He was God, but I was scared. I thought these people were crazy. And I had classmates who were wonderful persons and who were in the prayer group. So in the classroom, I would talk to them, but when I see them outside, I would avoid them because I know they're coming for prayer meeting. And I think in Stella Maris, I really was farthest from God, very farthest from prayer, absolutely despising the charismatic. That was my faith status.
So when would you say, Maria, that your real encounter with God happened in your life?
So there were several moments in my college years, especially when I was so cold to God, when I felt there was something beyond. And one was when I had this heavy asthmatic attack and we were having this trip to Rajasthan, and a classmate of mine, she was a nun, she decided to pray over me and I died of embarrassment. I didn't like it. But the next morning I actually realized that my wheezing disappeared. And I felt, okay, there is something. But in fact, I had this great fear of my future. Because I, as much as my family was strong about being Catholic and going for Sunday Mass, I believe the top priority above everything else was that we should have a profession. And especially because I was the only girl, I was the youngest at home. My parents would always say that I need to stand on my own feet. I must make it big in life. I should have a profession. And so I didn't want to make a mistake about this one thing. And so when I was coming to the end of my graduation, I was so worried about making the right decision. I have, not by choice, but palmists have come my way, tarot card readers, and somehow nobody gave an answer about, yeah, it's not I went looking for them. People have come home and then they know, and I'm like excited, okay, tell me about my future. But nothing really fit in, and that's when someone told me about, my two friends were talking about going to this place called Divineretreatcenter, and I have no clue. Kerala is like the next planet for me, you know, especially when you're from two neighboring states, you don't really like each other, though all my friends were from the state. But they told me about this retreat, and they said that there are people who are very gifted over there, practically what you'd call as a spiritual astrologer. So you go and speak to them and they'll tell you your future. And I thought, fine, I do believe in God. I believe He has a plan for our life. He knows the future of my life. So I thought, why not go to this place? And I had no inkling that this was charismatic. But at the same time, because it was another place, I was quite ready to go. And I thought, even if I have to stand on my head and say hallelujah, I do it because I wanted to know about my future. And that was when, on the last day of my third year, college was over that evening, three of us took a train. And I believe that's a big miracle because my parents are very protective of me. They wouldn't even allow me to travel on my own, walk on the road alone. You know, they were so scared daughter will get kidnapped. And so they actually sent me with two of my classmates to Kerala, to this Catholic retreat center. Of course, there were distant family members who had gone there, who got like amazing healings and stuff like this. So that was when I came to the retreat. Now, I came to the retreat only to find out about my future, but for the first, I just finished my third year. My last exam, final semester over. That evening, we're taking the train coming to this place. Came here with this purpose, but in the course of the week, for the first time in my life, I'm hearing about Jesus all the time. I'm hearing these like long talks about Jesus, about God, and it was during the course of this retreat that something completely changed in my heart. I remember hearing this talk about Jesus going to Bartimaeus, a blind beggar, and asking him, "What can I do for you?" And I was stumped. I was stumped by the personality of Jesus, and I knew I love him. I believe it's a love that's there in every one of our hearts always. It's just that we have to discover it. And I wanted to live for him. But of course, I didn't ever think of a full-time, you know, I never thought of coming back even to Divine. I didn't ever think of anything religious, but I thought wherever I am, I wanted to live my life for Jesus. That one retreat transformed my life, and when I went back, I'm a person who never keeps any decisions. I'm obsessive about making schedules, making resolutions, and I never keep any of these. But I believe that's where I experienced the power of God, because when I came back, it was like daily mass. And just a couple of months before that, my parish began a Eucharistic adoration. I would sit for 1 hour, I don't know how to pray, and I'm all the time thinking, "Lord, I don't know how to pray." I'm thinking, "How are these people praying?" But I was there, and I believe that daily mass and personal prayer helped me to further discover what I was called for.
So before we talk about your whole discernment process of how you became a full-timer and how you started serving in Divine, so what really tipped you off to make that decision, Maria? Like, when did you decide, okay, I'm going to be a full-timer in Divine? Was there a day that you decided like that?
No, I never thought of coming to Divine. See, I've come here several times for retreat, for the youth retreats. And I didn't see myself fitting into this place. One thing was I was English speaking and young, and I was a girl, and I didn't find anyone like that at that time here. I wanted to live for God, and I had this time of personal prayer. But interestingly, I think it was during the course of my personal prayer, I knew I wanted to live for Jesus. How, I did not want to know. I did not know. And at one moment, I'm preparing for my civil services meanwhile, because my parents want me to, not because I wanted to. And my mother meets a person who is supposedly gifted in prophecy. And so she took me there. And that was a negative experience, which turned out, I think, for the best, because this lady said many things. And one of the things, you know, when my mother asked her about me doing civil services, the lady said, "Oh, she will never get it." And I was so happy. The next thing I asked her is, "Can I serve the Lord?" And she said, "What will God do with you? You're a woman. So you're a girl. You think you start praying for the man you're to marry." And I was a bit upset about it, but I was not affected much, but my mother was affected. So she thought, "I'm now wasting my time going for prayer meeting and all that." And meanwhile, I started telling the Lord, "Lord, you don't need me, but I really want to live for you." And I was a little hurt about it, especially because my mother was taking it seriously. And at one point of time, I was so pressurized. I told the Lord, "Lord, if you don't want me to live full time for you," see, by then I haven't a clear idea, but I knew I wanted to live for him. I said, "Fine, but whatever, I need you, so I will continue to pray. But if you want me to live for you, I need a sign." I was feeling guilty about testing God and asking God for a sign, but it kind of came to a point where my parents weren't very happy about me going for this prayer meeting, that intercession, this Bible class. So I actually asked God for a sign, and I asked him to give me a cross, because I had lost the crucifix I had. So I asked God to give me a sign, and I said, God, if you want me to live for you, give me a cross. And I gave him a deadline. I said, 1 week's time. So the first 2 days, I actually went and met people who I thought would give me some kind of gift. You know, people like old people, pious people who give me a cross. Nothing came, and by the third day I kind of gave up. I was sitting in my house, and I was looking at the Sacred Heart picture. I was telling Jesus, fine, if you don't want me to serve you, fine. And that's when my mom comes to me. My mom is like, who's like totally against my going for prayer meeting and porta and all this. She comes to me with a brown cover and says, I want you to get this blessed. And she said, I only want two or three remaining you can keep. Now, she didn't tell me what it was. I emptied the brown cover in my hand. It was a whole, maybe about 15 crosses, you know. And even at that moment, you know, hard and dumb as I was, I thought it's a coincidence. That which should come for my mother, if it came from some saintly priest or nun, you know, I would have said, wow. So, but I believe that was one moment. Another moment was when I was going to sleep. I remember one night I clearly got this verse, Matthew 19:29. I was very tired that day, and I didn't want to open the Bible, but because I was not getting sleep, this word was going on coming to my mind, and I put on the torchlight. My Bible was next to me. I opened and I saw this verse, you know, where Jesus says, whoever leaves father and mother and brother and land and house will receive 100 more. And I always thought it was a boring verse because I thought it was for priests and nuns. I read it, I felt very happy, but I still didn't think it was for me. So this was how I slowly was being drawn to the fact that I want to live for God. And Divine Retreat Center, I was always involved with their youth ministry. After a while, they started inviting me to come and serve here. I didn't know if that was for me. I wasn't really sure about that. I believe it was just that over time, that's through certain concrete circumstances, I ended up here.
So it was a process in which you discerned your calling, like you wanted to become a full-timer. So were you comfortable with that calling, Maria? Did you immediately say, yes, yeah, I'm going to serve God full-time? Was it like that?
See, Joseph, when I wanted to live for God, and I started talking about it, and I remember on one occasion, the youth leader who was then at Divine called me, and the director at Divine called me to come and serve here. I spoke to my mom about it because she's the more pious one, and she heard my testimony. She was very moved, but the next morning she came and blasted me and told me, you go now and get a job. But after that, they brought in everybody that they could, you know. A lot of people came to advise me, and I think that helped me to discern, because they were telling me, you're escaping life. You know, you're not being realistic with your talent. I was a postgraduate. I'd already familiar with the print media. He said, with your thing, you should be, you know, doing good things outside. The church has enough people inside. We need people who are in the world and who are working for the kingdom. Very valid things. And there was also this question, like, you know, am I wanting to serve the Lord because I see some very glamorous people? There are some awesome people serving the Lord and everybody admires them. So I believe all these pressures only purified my motives. So am I wanting to serve the Lord for the Lord or for myself? And it was around this time that I quit my job. I was working with a magazine, a Catholic magazine. I was so blessed over there. I learned a lot over there, the new leader. And but I quit it because I really started feeling this pressure that I wanted to give myself completely to the Lord. And that was when my parents decided at the same time that they were sending me abroad to study media. So on the eve of that, I went for a discernment retreat by a Jesuit priest, Father Expai. And that was where, you know, discerning, like, do I want to serve the Lord full time? And also the question of vocation. It's all intertwined, you see. So I remember at this point, this priest asked me to list out the reasons why I would want to serve God, why I would not want to serve God full time, but you know. So for both the positive and the negative, and similarly, why I would want to marry, why I would want to be single. And it was these, this retreat, and especially the resistance I faced, that made it clear to me that the way that the Lord was setting in front of me. Of course, when my parents sent me abroad, I lost all hope of serving God because they were spending a lot of money, and they were very clear that I either should get married or become a nun. And my mother also told me that I won't last a day in a convent. She said, after 1 week, you'll be back. But so I was like totally, because I couldn't break my parents' heart. I know they love me very much. So I, before going abroad, I came and told the people at Divine that this is impossible. But when I went abroad, my personal prayer continued. I was so blessed. I had a chapel close by. There was daily mass, 1 hour of prayer. And it was during one of those nights when I was praying in the chapel, I heard a voice inside my heart where the Lord told me, it is I who brought you so far. I who have, if I survived in prayer, it is only God's grace. It's not because I'm a person with a great power of endurance. And when the Lord told me, it is I who brought you this far, I will take you to the end. It was that day that peace came into my heart. I didn't worry after that, am I going to serve the Lord or not? I knew it was His business, not mine. And from there, things just flowed like a river flowing, you know. It took its own course. There was an invitation from Divine. Because a TV channel was starting, I'm finishing my media course, I come to India and a TV channel is starting, and when I presented it to my parents that they are starting a TV channel at Divine, it was my dad who said, oh, so you're getting a job? And I said yes, and there was absolutely no resistance. The Lord opened the doors at the right time, opened hearts at the right time. The Lord made it clear that I can do nothing. I can neither desire to do good, nor can I be secure about what I'm going to do, nor can I. I'm a person who's very good at convincing my parents right from childhood. But in this one area, I realized that they would listen to nothing. And this way, I saw the Lord opening their heart.
So did you ever have to negotiate with God, like, you know, when you decided to go full time? Because we see in the scripture, like when Peter, God asked Peter to follow him, he just said, put down your nets and follow him. And Peter did not have any time to negotiate with Jesus, with you, take care of my family, my mother-in-law, my friends. So I always feel when God calls you, you can tell either yes or no, but you can't negotiate. Was it the same case with you?
See, for me, when God called me to serve, for me, it was the greatest, it was something beyond my dreams. Even now, some people say, are you doing a sacrifice? Oh, you're sacrificing much. Honestly, I'm saying this with absolute honesty, I don't see any sacrifice in my life. I feel so blessed, so blessed, so grateful to every day that the Lord allows me to serve Him, you know, and I'm so grateful for that. There's absolutely nothing that I've given up, and God is too good.
Yeah, so there would have been a time as you were serving in Divine when you hit the marriageable age according to Indian standards, and there would have been a lot of pressure both from people who were working in Divine and also from your parents, right, to get married?
See, God is, I think, very sensitive to the fact that I'm a very delicate darling. So He somehow has shielded me. Like, before I came to Divine, and yes, for a few years after that, my mother's sincerest prayer was that I should marry, because that means security as she saw it. I was already of marriageable age in the traditional sense of the word, because all my cousins got married when they were like 21, 22. So I was 26 when I reached here. So by around that time, I think there were discussions, but I was never in the know of it. My parents were so protective, screening everything. I don't think they found anybody good enough for their wonderful daughter. So my mom did try to speak to me about marriage. And even when I went for this discernment retreat, one thing was that I'm a person who gives 100%, and I grew up with my mother as a role model. I thought I would marry like her, wear saris like her. I wanted to have 3 children exactly like her, 2 boys and 1 girl. That was my idea of life. But after the retreat, somehow that just got faded away. It was not like I didn't want to marry or I wanted to be single, but it's just that I wanted to live for God, and that was like a fire that took over my heart. So one reason why I wanted to marry at my discernment retreat, what I felt was, I felt that when you marry and you're married, you're living for another person, and when you have children, you're living for your children. And I believe that's what holiness is, when you can completely forget yourself and live for another. And I was afraid that single life would make me selfish. Because when you are single, you live around your schedule and your priorities. So that was my big fear of single life. I didn't want to become a very nasty, self-centered person. And I believe that was when this priest told me that you can always be self-centered and selfish and nasty in any state of life. And during another retreat, my mother said, your husband will be your security. And I... That was when I spoke to Brother Fritz Mascarenhas. I said, you know, I want to live for the Lord completely, but you know, my husband will be my security. And he said, what nonsense? Your God is your security. And you know, those words really have been my stronghold, super stronghold. At Divine, I've never faced this question of why don't you get married? I believe, yeah, sometimes people say a person doesn't get married, they could be, you know, dissatisfied. I believe you can be married and dissatisfied. It's about, if you're born of the Spirit, you think on the terms of the Spirit. You don't need to have what the people of the world insist that you have. And I believe when God calls you to whichever vocation it is, as you discover Him, you'll be the happiest in your vocation. And I think I'm one of the happiest people I've met. I don't know. I think so, yeah.
So, but during the course of, you know, from 26 to 30, Maria, so did you have the desire to get married? Did, like, you know, was it like conflating your thought process, whether should I be single or should I get married?
You know, I have not had much time to think of marriage. I believe it must be that a couple of times people did speak to me about marriage, and when I prayed about it, on one occasion I actually brought it in prayer, and when I brought it in prayer, I experienced a deep sadness in my heart, because I wanted, see, one thing I wanted was to do God's will, and I was open to, I mean, I didn't have any condition. But I knew that I experienced a lot of freedom in single life to give myself 100%. And I didn't feel lonely. I've never felt lonely as such. I've got a very close family. My family is like very close-knit. And so I've never felt the need. I've never felt like, oh, why didn't I get married? I've never felt that. There were times I felt like, God, why did you bring me into the media ministry? There were nights when I cried and told the Lord, why did you do this to me? Because why did you bring me here? Or why this? Why that? But that was, I believe those were moments of, you know, when I was struggling also to do something good with the media ministry. Because this media is so tough. You especially as an amateur, I've just come from training and I'm thrown into a TV, and you do it with a lot of wonderful ideas in your head, and what comes out is so different from what you... And a lot of people could criticize what you do. And so it was very painful. I thought, why God? Why this tough thing? But I knew God brought me there.
And after a certain period, did you feel the shame because of people telling you, oh, why are you not getting married? Because this one question people asked me to ask you. See, whatever you're doing now, you could have easily done it. You could easily do it even as a married person, right?
Yep. You know, I think it ultimately is what God designs. Why is my life not like the next person's life? Well, in fact, you know, Joseph, this may be surprising that many married people and even religious people have come and told me, I wish I was where you are. I believe it's about hearing God's call. When you're married, you must know this comes from God. When you're religious, you must know this is God's call. I believe people have never asked me, why are you not getting married? No, it was like, I don't know, maybe, I really don't know why nobody asked me that in such clear terms. Even my mother would, I think she told others, she's not told me directly anything. I never felt that kind of a pressure. See, there are people who are married, like in Divine, there are several couples, some with children, some without children, and they're doing extraordinarily well. And well, I think even as a married person, you can do so much. We sometimes tend to evaluate ministry by the number of things we do. And I believe that's very superficial, very cheap. It's about, in fact, how deeply I can be in Christ. And even if I don't give a talk, even if I don't do any, flamboyant ministry, I can be a very powerful, and I'm not speaking poetry, but I can be a very powerful presence of Christ. I can carry the presence of Christ, and that can make more difference than I go and give 100 talks and I've not got my connection with the Lord. So being a single, I just feel it's another dimension of the call of God. It's made me more available to Christ. I don't have any, like St. Paul says, when you're married, you have to worry about your spouse. I don't have any worries. I don't have any worries about my future. I have absolutely no worries about finances. And I believe when you're married and you have a wife or a husband and children, these are real concerns. It could be a challenge in ministry when your concern is, how do I get my kids' education? If you have that faith level that God will provide, fine. But otherwise, I really think that in my case, the single vocation was something that really enabled me to be absolutely free. I'm a person who's like, I think 24/7 available for God's work. And He's been ensuring that I'm not idle and not losing track. He's been ensuring the moment I lose track, I very quickly get pushed back. So, yeah, I really don't see it as a disadvantage. I don't see it as different. But I just see it as something equal and beautiful. But it's all about, have you heard God's voice? I can always be in the best place and grudge somebody for what they have because I don't have that.
Yeah. So my last question in this regard before we move on to singlehood, Maria. So you said you didn't have to give up anything. You didn't have to sacrifice much to, you know, say yes to your calling. Do you think that not getting married was something that you had to give up? Do you feel like that now?
I really don't. I never felt that way. Never felt that way.
You're so blessed then. Yeah.
We have to make a conscious choice, yeah. You know. Just to give you a little insight now, see, in the charismatic ministry, I could have a charism of, say, doing media. Another person can have a charism of leadership. Mm. Third person, charism of preaching or healing or prophecy.
Yeah.
Now, if my eye is set on that, I will feel very inadequate where I am. Mm. But when I am able to be grateful for what I have, I'm able to appreciate the other's call as well.
Mm, yeah, that's very true. Yeah. And Maria, when I put out posters regarding your interview, so a lot of people asked me to ask these questions to you. So I'm going to put those forward.
I got a message. So someone sent me questions and I thought, what question? And I thought, oh no.
So I'm going to put those questions forward to you and you let me know your opinion on that. So the first thing people ask me to ask you is, you already mentioned about the fact that, you know, insecurity of singlehood. So when you're married, you're, as you say, your spouses are your security, or in your religious life, the congregation takes care of you, or the diocese takes care of you. So how do you, how would you answer a person who has this question of insecurity in terms of discerning their singlehood?
My security has to be founded in the love of God. And this comes through prayer. This also comes through experiences. Because let me tell you this, this is something that could be perhaps relevant. I was at one point, I was very worried if I fall sick. Okay? If I fall sick, what happens? Because here everyone is dedicated to the ministry. Like you said, if I was in a convent, the other nuns have to look after me. If I am married, my people have to look after me. Or even if I was at home, my parents would have to look after me. And I remember I was worried about this. This question came to my mind. And a month later, I was down with pneumonia. I never knew pneumonia existed. I was down with pneumonia. And I didn't tell my parents because they would get so panicky. So I was taken from Divine to the nearest hospital. And there were two young friends and another two, three friends who actually came and cared for me more than my family could have. You know, they were so loving, so attentive, so happy to be able to help. And it was such a joyful stay in the hospital. A lot of people visiting me, bringing me things to eat and chocolates and so much of love and affection, and I was fine. I came back. A month later, out of the blue, it was the end of Jan, I developed this disc, something to do with a disc, yeah. And it wasn't a prolapse, I think. I was not able to get out of bed, and I didn't know what happened. I thought I was paralyzed. I didn't even know what was happening. I thought I'm like some paralysis, I'm not able to move. But that was a scary time. But even then, I feel the community, I believe when a community prays together, there's a lot of love. And there were so many people there to help, and so much of support. And till I was back on track. Every time I've fallen sick, I've experienced the way the Lord providing, to the extent that once I was telling my mother, you know, all this, and she said, "Oh, I think when I fall sick, I should come there." I believe when you're in a community that prays, there is love, and then God takes responsibility for your life, whatever your vocation be. When God takes responsibility for your life, He's responsible. He's not an irresponsible, careless parent or spouse.
I remember an incident in the Bible when Jesus comes and heals mother-in-law of Peter, though Peter did not go and ask Jesus to do the healing. Okay, so the second question, Maria, is, even though the Catholic Church recognizes singlehood as an occasion, in India especially, singlehood is considered as something to be shameful of. So a lot of people have this sense of shame when they are discerning singlehood. So how would you address that? Because there are a lot of ulterior motives that people assign to singlehood, because maybe she has some problem, or
she didn't find a husband.
Exactly.
She didn't find
or a, she's too.
He's a misfit.
Yeah, exactly.
God has a plan for your life, right? And He's the one who put you together in your mother's womb. And this, when it says, when the Lord says He molded you, it doesn't at all, or doesn't just refer to your physical features, or it refers to every context of your life, the parents you have, the struggles you've had, the blessings, the talents. And this is where there may be certain moments when we may find certain handicaps. We may find people don't trust us, or they look down on you. Now, I came from a home that's traditionally Catholic, but very educated, and I believe somewhere their vision was rather wide. So I never faced that kind of discrimination. I really think that when your heart calls you to, say, give your life completely in this particular call of being single, you need to know that the Lord is your glory. Like when you are single, people can talk anything they want about you. So I've had a couple of instances where people have spoken as they felt. And it was extremely painful. I was extremely angry. And I brought it in prayer, and the Lord insisted I forgive. And I was furious with God for asking me to forgive, but I forgave. I was furious with the authorities because they refused to take a stance. And I'm so glad they didn't, because whoever spoke against me, I believe God vindicated me. And today I'm so glad that no human corrected them, because in time, only because, see, for me, God is my shield. God is my advocate. God is my joy. And even on one occasion when one person spread a big rumor about me, a very interesting rumor about me, I realized God, even those who are not close to me or not favorable to me, I heard that one of them said, "You say this about anyone else, I'll believe, but not about Maria." And I don't think it's because she loved me or knew anything about me, but because I believe it was God shielding me. So when we make a decision for the Lord, and your singlehood or marriage should be for the Lord, not because you don't get a husband. You know, you need to ask the Lord, "Lord, would you like me to live for you?" And I must know the depths of joy don't come from having a husband or having my own selfish life, my whole world to myself, or having a convent. No, you must decide, do you want to live for Jesus? You want to live for Jesus, it's the best thing. It's the only wisest thing you can do. If you want to live for Jesus, Lord, how do you want me to live? You want me to marry? You bring the fellow. You bring the girl. You want me to live for you? You fill my heart. And the Lord will not fail you. There will be moments when you have to suffer, but you can suffer in any state of life. You can suffer in a convent. You can suffer in a marriage. You can suffer. Like, everybody goes through these moments like, "Oh, what a horrible situation I'm in." But that is where, when you wait in prayer, the Lord will fight your battle. He's not disconnected. He is extremely protective of those who turn to Him. And really, Joseph, it's so beautiful to have that experience of the Lord filling your heart and protecting you and fighting your battle.
So my last question, Maria. So, as you rightly said, being a single should not be for selfish reasons, because today in our culture, you see a lot of people want to concentrate on their career, or they just want to live a carefree life, and hence they decide to be single. Like, so how do people who are discerning kind of, clarify that in their own calling and in their own vocation if they're called to be single?
I really think single life isn't advisable for most people, because there's nothing as blessed as a family. Our vocation is to love, and being in a family facilitates and ensures you love. I really would not recommend you to live a single life unless you're dead sure. You're really sure. And I really don't think, I see a lot of my friends, my close friends, are married people. And I love and adore them really, because they are so close to the Lord, so beautiful, and in their families, so devoted to each other. You know, there are a lot of things you have to give up. You have to say no to everything else when you say yes to one thing. But I believe that makes you all the more free. So don't be single until you're really sure that the Lord, you're single, you only, especially when you're single, you have to be single for the Lord, nothing else. Not because of your profession, not because you're going to lose out on your education. all that does not matter at all. It's only love that matters. And I really would tell you that love, ask the Lord to help you to love, to give you a life, and he takes over.
Okay, last question, Maria. I almost forgot this. So you have been the face of Catholic youth in India. You know, a lot of people from all over India come to Divine Retreat Center for the youth retreats that you conduct and so many other programs for youth. So a lot of people want to know, like, how do you live your spiritual life on a day-to-day basis? Like, what are the moments of spiritual activities in your life that keeps you going?
Mm-hmm. Daily Mass, because the Mass is as close as we can get to God while we are on this earth. There's nothing like Holy Mass, yeah. There's nothing at all like Holy Mass. Second thing is personal prayer. There's so many things that that we cannot do. In fact, there's very little that we can do. There's nothing we can do, but in the time of personal prayer, I'm allowing him to work. The third thing would be, I believe, listening to people. See, what makes me do my ministry, not for my sake or not for the sake of the Divine Youth Ministry, not for Divine, but what I think really makes my ministry pure and for Jesus is because I meet a lot of young people who go through impossible circumstances, who struggle, who have genuine struggles in sin and in pain and the broken the family. And I, in fact, when one of my close friends had a nervous breakdown several years ago, a year after my first retreat, it was then that I told Jesus, Lord, if I could give my entire life to help one young person know your love, I knew that this friend would not have had a breakdown if he knew that God loves. For him, his professional failure seemed the end of his life. Now, if he knew that God, who God is and what God can do with your failures, he would not have had that breakdown. And I saw this person so transformed. That's when I told Jesus, even if I give my entire life, and if one person can be saved from reaching this situation, my life would have been worth living. And through the youth retreats, I've seen thousands and thousands finding hope. And I believe, being in touch with the sufferings of people, the sufferings of your family, sufferings of those around you is what also opens you to the power of God.
Yeah, and Maria, so this interview is going to be seen by people all over India especially. So is there a message that you would like to convey to Indian youth, Indian Catholic youth? What would you tell them?
Yes, I believe every young person, every person needs to know this, that God is a God who's constantly creating. And he's creating because of love. Love is creative. And so whatever is there in your life, could be something ugly, could be something painful, could be something boring. When I bring it to God, he will do something so tremendously marvelous. So the one thing every young person needs to know is God is the beauty of life. The ugliest mistakes of your life will be one day what you're most proud about, because he takes those ashes and does something marvelous, that your life becomes a blessing for the world. So love God, and if you don't know how to love him, just try to love him and he takes over.
And St. Catherine of Siena said, Maria, that be what you're meant to be, and you will set the world on fire. So do you feel on fire?
At least if my heart is on fire, I'll be happy. My heart has to be on fire. And I think I'm a perfectionist. One side of me is a perfectionist, so I'm always thinking like, Lord, I'm not loving you enough.
Yeah.
I'm not praying enough. But on the whole, I think my heart is on fire. I don't know the world is
Yeah.
I'm not sure the world is on fire. I think my heart is on fire for him.
Yes. So I have come to Divine Retreat Center twice in my life. Once when I was in my 9th standard and 4 years back. Oh. And then I have got to see you in Bangalore and in Chennai when you come to conduct Magnificat. But I've never got the opportunity to speak with you
personally. Yeah. Yes.
So it's like a dream come true for me.
I hope we meet again in person.
Yeah. So thank you for taking the time to share your experience.
Thank you, Dinesh, for the ministry you're doing.
Yeah. Thank you so
much. It's really beautiful. I really would like to meet you because I think your life and your ministry is a witness to how God leads and God takes over. God bless you and your ministry.